Relation will come to order. Clerk will call the roll.
Chair Landgraf.
Here.
Vice Chair Garrow. Bell. Dean.
Here.
Kemple.
Here.
Lopez. Meza.
Here.
Morales Shaw.
Here.
Reynolds.
Present.
Okay, a quorum is present. Welcome to my colleagues on the committee, to all of the witnesses who have joined us today, and everybody watching the proceedings. Appreciate your attendance. I do apologize for the late start. We had several members who had formal hearings and votes to make. So thank you for bearing with us. To anyone wishing to testify before the committee, please register at the kiosks located in the hallways behind the hearing rooms. If you require assistance in registering or testifying, please see our assistant committee clerk, Praz, who is here at the front. This time, the chair lays out House Bill 2502, and the chair recognizes Representative Reynolds to explain the bill.
Thank you, thank you, Chairman Landgraf and members, for the opportunity to lay out House Bill 2502. This bill would authorize the State Energy Conservation Office, a unit of the Comptroller of Public Accounts, to begin a revolving loan guarantee program for energy audits and energy efficiency upgrades of residential and commercial existing buildings, which could include public or private buildings. Currently, CECO runs a successful revolving loan program known as Lone Star, which uses oil overcharge collected to loan out the public for public buildings energy efficiency retrofits. Under the program, lower utility bills and savings help pay back the loan to the state, creating an evergreen fund. This bill would expand on this successful program by using available federal funds from the bipartisan infrastructure law approved in a bipartisan congressional action in 2021 to begin a new program at CECO. The Energy Efficiency Revolving Loan Fund Capitalization Grant Program is a program established at the DOE designed to provide capitalization grants to states to establish a revolving loan fund under which the state shall provide loans and grants for energy efficiency audits, upgrades, and retrofits to increase energy efficiency and improve the comfort of buildings. Currently, CECO is in the process of applying for these federal funds administered by the Department of Energy, and an estimated $10 to $15 million could be made available to the state of Texas in 2023. Under the bill, the federal funds could be augmented as needed by the state funds and private capital to increase the availability of the funds. But even if no additional funds were made available, the program could begin with the federal funds. The bill instructs CECO to follow federal guidance in creating rules for the program, but does not allow money to be used for grants, technical assistance, or administration. In addition, the bill instructs CECO to work with the Energy Systems Laboratory at Texas A&M to assess the effectiveness of the program and quantify any energy savings and emissions reductions that result from the program. Those emission reductions can be used as part of the state's implementation plan to meet federal Clean Air Act ozone standards. This is already standard practice for the existing program, but this will assure that the new program would also account for in our emissions reductions. Providing low or zero interest loans in private and public entities could help customers save money on their electric, water, and gas bills, reduce pollution, and help make our electric grid more reliable. Because House Bill 2502 at least would initially use federal funding for the program, it will not increase costs for the state. If the state chooses, it could add money to the program, but that is not required under the bill. While many Texans can take advantage of other federal utility and state funding, this program would help both public and private buildings get access to low-interest loans to help make our grid and their buildings more reliable. Members, we did, if you notice, there is a fiscal note. We're working with the Comptroller's Office. We will have a committee substitute based on some suggestions that they have given me that would eliminate the fiscal note. And so I'll be coming back to you after, which we didn't get a chance to get that soon enough for a committee substitute. So we'll be working with that to get a revised bill that would encompass the recommendations for the Comptroller's Office so that we can eliminate any fiscal note. And with that, I will reserve the right to close and open it up for any questions.
Well, we'll certainly recognize your right to close. Representative Meza.
Thank you.
Chairman Reynolds?
Yes.
So I was reading through about the background and purpose,
It's a revolving loan fund program.
Correct.
But you're expanding it with a grant program. And the grant program would be going to the revolving loan fund program, right?
Yes.
So I was originally going to ask when do you decide when to give a loan, when do you decide to give a grant? But it's never grants. It's always loans. It's just that the grants go to the loan fund program. Am I understanding that correctly?
I believe so, but we do have some experts that can make sure that your understanding is correct.
So ask the question again.
Yes. We do have some expert witnesses that are.
All right. I will do that then. Thank you.
Members, any other questions? All right.
Thank you.
We do have a few witnesses. At this time, the chair calls Kenneth Flippin. Welcome back. We appreciate you being here. We show you registered as Kenneth Flippin on behalf of the U.S. Green Building Council Texas chapter and on behalf of yourself, and that you are testifying for the bill. Is that correct?
That's correct.
Thank you. Please proceed with your testimony.
Thank you, Chairman, and thank you for letting us talk about this bill. We really do think this bill is an excellent best practice for many reasons. We think it's one of those grid bills that pulls energy off the grid and does it from the demand side. You can see all the different reasons. Cyrus will cover some of these, but I want to point out there's three really conservative good governance principles that I think this bill focuses on. The first one is that it really focuses on more of what we'd call like a hand up versus a handout. The people that are in the middle that want help getting their energy efficiency loans, but they want to pay for it themselves, those are the people that this is going to help. Right now, they can't afford, you know, a high interest rate to pay for all these things and then to get the benefit. The revolving loan fund is brilliant because basically you're able to get what you need, and then your savings on your bills will be able to cover a lot of that cost because you're paying it out over time. So that's the first principle. The second principle is it unleashes the market from the demand side. In other words, we know that we're trying to solve our grid. We know that we're trying to do a lot with the supply side. But on the demand side, our consumers don't have the ability to really upgrade their technology in a way that makes them more efficient. This would give them that. And so it basically unleashes Texans to help solve the grid. Thirdly, and lastly, I would say that the revolving loan program is obviously a best practice because you're using the money over and over and over again. The money that one person loans, pays back in a few years, can be used by another person. Therefore, we're taking that $10 or $15 million of federal money, we're using it over and over and over again, and that would basically bring us tens of thousands of Texans, businesses, residents, that are able to take advantage of this program.
Great. Well, Mr. Flippin, thank you for your testimony. Members, any questions? Representative Meza.
Yes. I'm not sure who to ask. I'll just ask you, and if you can't answer, Mr. Flippin.
Yeah, I'll do the best I can.
All right. So you heard me ask Chairman Reynolds about a loan program, but then we're expanding it to grants, and it sounds like, but the grants are going to the loan program.
Yes.
So is it a loan program or a grant program? It sounds to me like it's a loan program.
Well, so what's happening is that the money that would be captured by this bill are basically federal grants, but they're federal grants that are coming to the state to be determined how to use. And so the state could do anything with those things. It could give grants to low-income people saying, hey, we're going to help you do energy efficiency. Instead, it says, no, we're going to take this federal grant, and on the state level, we're going to use it in a revolving loan program in order to help out as many people as we can by using it as a loan that's either guaranteed or low interest.
I believe I saw that the loans could even be zero interest loans.
That's correct, depending on how they designed it.
So I like the part about helping low-income people who maybe live in homes that are not very well insulated and whatever, be able to afford to make their home more energy efficient.
Yes.
But it's not just for low-income homeowners, is it? It has in here that it says private and public entities. So who all is eligible for this program?
So, private entities would, be individual residences, but it would also be like small commercial businesses. And then public entities would be like if you had a city or county or library or somebody like that that had a building that they wanted to do energy efficiency upgrades, they could potentially too get those funds.
Oh, okay. Not corporations?
Well, a corporation in the sense of a business that has a building, that's a small business, I think there is a cap on how big these can go. I'm not exactly sure how it's designed in that aspect, but businesses could use it. But I think it's targeting like small commercial and basically residential.
So it sounds like a good program to me. What do you think?
I think it's an excellent program. I think it's the best use of our federal money, that we get more energy off the grid, we could get more homes protected with energy efficiency, so that if there is another storm and people are out of power, their survivability goes up. For all those reasons, I think it's an excellent bill.
Any reservations about the bill?
Well, the only reservation that I would have is the fiscal note that was put on there, but I think that if we can find a way to get past that, that would be great. I would also say this, though, like, good programs sometimes do cost money, and if it does cost a little bit of money, the amount that we would benefit from it would be greater than that. And so I hope we find a way to work it out with CECO that we can do it without a fiscal note.
Okay. Thank you.
Thank you. Members, any other questions? All right. The chair recognizes Chairman Guetta present, as well as Representative Bell of Kaufman. Chair calls Cyrus Reed.
You know what? Belay that order. Let me take him back. I'll recycle those. No, just kidding.
Well, 1 second. Before we get anybody talking, we have you on the record as Cyrus Reed on behalf of the Lone Star Chapter of the Sierra Club, and that you were testifying for the bill. Is that correct?
Very much so. I'm here to support HB 2502 and any future bill that fixes the fiscal note. And I'm not going to read from my testimony, but let me try to answer some of the questions. So, bipartisan bill passed in 2021. One of the programs in that bill allows states, and specifically state energy offices like CECO, which is a unit of the comptroller, to apply for that funding. And we heard in a meeting yesterday that it's not 10 to 15 million, Representative Reynolds, it's actually 22 million. So a little more than we thought. And those funds can be used for a variety of purposes, but under this bill, it would be used to set up a revolving loan fund for private and public buildings, essentially. And the language in the bill does say it can be used for technical assistance, administration grants. That would be determined by CECO through rulemaking. So the bill doesn't say they have to give out grants. It just is permissive. It allows. The best thing we could do is use the bulk of the money for the revolving loan, because then that becomes an evergreen fund. And let me address the fiscal note, just so you guys are aware. The fiscal note is related to somewhat of a concern by the comptroller that if we open up the program to private residences, they would probably not want to do that themselves. They would need to hire a third party or an additional bank, because they already have an existing program for public buildings. And so there's some sense that it could be risky, expensive for them to open up to private buildings. So we're going to, I'll work with the representative to see if we can allay that concern and figure out how we can move forward. But in the grand scheme of things, whether this money ultimately goes to private residences or public buildings, so libraries, school districts, community centers, it's still going to help ultimately taxpayers, ratepayers save money. It's also going to help make our grid more resilient. It will also save, honestly, water, gas, other utilities as well, because anything, you know, if you weatherize a home or a business, you're also saving, as all of us who suffered through Winter Storm Uri or Winter Storm Mara here in Austin and lost power, we know if you live in a two-story home, for example, and you happen to have done a great job making your top floor energy efficient but haven't done squat on your bottom floor, just speaking from personal experience, you're going to be a lot safer on that top floor than on that bottom floor. So anything we can do to help, whether it's public or private buildings, is a good thing. The second aspect of this bill, I can't remember if Mr. Reynolds mentioned it. We want to make sure we do a good job with this federal money. We don't want to waste it. So we want to make sure there's good reporting and that we get credit. And this is why it's an environmental reg, right? We get credit for any emissions reductions. So if we reduce energy load and we have to maybe run a few gas plants less, that's helping cleaning our air in Dallas area, in Houston area, Sorry, you're not in Houston area. I was looking for a Houston area for person. Penny, yeah. So that would be helpful as well. And we already do that in some of our programs, and this bill would require CECO in this program to also analyze that as part of it. So for those reasons, we think it's a good bill. And happy to answer any other questions.
Members, any more questions? Seeing none, thank you.
Thank you.
Chair calls Victoria Munoz. Good afternoon. We show you as registered Victoria Munoz, testifying on behalf of yourself for the legislation. Is that correct?
Yes, that's correct.
Is your dad Ned Munoz?
Yes.
Uh-oh.
Oh. That's what I told him in the hallway. We'll see what kind of young lady he raised. It's a trap. Victoria, please proceed. Thank you for being here.
I'm here from Austin High. We were recently assigned a project where we pinpoint a global issue and try to solve it locally. So I thought that there would be no better way than just go straight to the source. And my global issue is air pollution. So buildings are one of the highest electricity users. However, new buildings account for a very small part of that energy use. It's the existing buildings that pull the greatest amount of electricity. So while new buildings must follow stronger energy codes, this bill will address the energy use of existing buildings by providing a source for much-needed loans for energy upgrades to existing buildings. Clean air is an issue that we all live and breathe on a daily basis, and unfortunately, much of that air is polluted and getting worse as our world grows. This bill will go a long way to address the missing piece of our building energy codes by using federal funds to help people voluntarily retrofit existing buildings to make them more efficient. Thank you for your time, and please vote in favor for HB 2502.
Thank you. Please show Representative Lopez present. Members, Mr. Reynolds.
I just wanted to commend you for being a young person that's here to testify. That's very impressive. It's very good when we see our young people involved in the process. So thank you not just for supporting the bill, but just for your presence today and being engaged. It takes a lot of courage. I know a lot of older people get nervous, but you seem very poised and like a seasoned veteran. So I just wanted to publicly commend you for your leadership. Thank you.
Thank you so much.
Victoria, thank you. And as Mr. Reynolds said, poised young lady, I know what you've had to overcome to to reach this point and to lay out a testimony and do it confidently, poised. We appreciate it. It's really kind of remarkable to most of us. Thank you very much.
Thank
Chairman,
you so much. Chairman.
Mr. Guerra.
I have to also commend you as well. And I echo my colleagues' positions on that. So thank you very much.
Thank you.
Is there anyone else wishing to testify on for or against HB 2502? If not, the chair recognizes Mr. Reynolds to close.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. Members, I will be working with the Comptroller's Office. We do have some suggested language that we discussed that would alleviate the fiscal note. I think that the focus and intent is to make sure that we have more energy efficiency and we use these resources from the federal government very fiscally. And with that, I'll ask for your favorable consideration once we get that committee sub to you. Thank you, and I'll close.
Thank you, Mr. Reynolds. HB 2502 will be left pending at this time. Chair lays out HB 3282 and recognizes Mr. Jones to explain the bill.
Thank you, Mr. Chair. Members, thank you for this opportunity to lay out HB 3282, which addresses an environmental and public health issue for many Texans. Currently in counties like mine, unincorporated areas are targets for dumping scrap tires. These tires, while out of sight and mind, still create many health and environmental issues for Texans who live near or travel through those areas. When tires are dumped, when there's no jurisdiction for regulation, it creates homes for mosquitoes and other nuisances and pests that live in and create diseases that causes serious problems for Texans. Additionally, it becomes the responsibility of the county to pay for the removal of the dump tires, which shifts the burdens to property taxpayers. Recently, cities across Texas have adopted ordinances to establish tire recycling facilities, as well as regulation of the disposal and recycling of tires, and have been a great result within waste mitigation. According to the Texas Commission on Environmental Quality, Texas leads the nation in the number of unauthorized scrap tires dumped across the state. The tire dumping and littering epidemic has caused various health as well as other issues in the county that have to clean up these messes, and also on the taxpayers' dimes, and also leaving Texans living around these scrap piles. House Bill 3282 permits counties to adopt an ordinance that will establish county tire recycling facilities. This bill will help mitigate illegal tire dumping in counties across the state and prevent economic and public health issues from affecting the lives of Texans. I look forward to your favorable consideration. We do have witnesses that are available that can speak to the issue and answer any questions. I'm also available to answer questions, Mr. Chairman, and with that, I reserve the right to close.
Thank you, Mr. Jones. We'll give you the right. Members, do we have any questions for Mr. Jones? Seeing none, we'll call you back up. Thank you, sir. Chair now calls. The chair now calls Rebecca Chanel. Ma'am, good afternoon. We show you registered as Rebecca Chanel, testifying on behalf of Dallas County Commissioners Court for the legislation. Is that correct?
That's correct.
Thank you, ma'am.
Thank you. Thank you, Mr. Chairman and members. My name is Rebecca Chanel on behalf of the Dallas County Commissioners Court, testifying in support of House Bill 3282. We want to thank Representative Jones for this bill. In Dallas County, we are constantly finding tires that have been dumped illegally, and we are seeking a solution to be able to mitigate illegal tire dumping, as well as to clean up current and prevent future negative impacts on health and safety of all Texans that comes from this piling up of these tires. HB 3282 establishes a way for TCEQ to be able to track the bad actors who are illegally dumping these scrap tires. With this tracking, counties will be able to know who is illegally disposing of the tires, thus know who to fine, and thus to pay for the cleanup, which is currently being paid by our shared county taxpayers. Additionally, for the future mitigation of these issues in unincorporated areas in counties, HB 3282 grants the optional authority of establishing a tire recycling facility. We ask the committee to look favorably on HB 3282, and with that, I'm happy to take any questions.
Thank you, Ms. Chanel. Excuse me. Thank you. Members, any questions? Thank you for being here.
Thank you.
Chair calls Rick Thompson. Ms. Thompson, we show you registered as Rick Thompson, testifying on behalf of County Judges, Commissioners Association of Texas, for the legislation. Is that correct?
Yes, sir.
Thanks, sir.
Appreciate it. Good afternoon. I want to thank you for the opportunity to be here. Just brought some written testimony. We had Judge Keeter, our state president, and our West Texas president, Commissioner Kirk Fry from Palmer County. They had to drive back to the panhandle today, but they didn't want to leave without leaving some information for y'all on what this bill can do for them. Counties are looking for tools to deal with this issue. There's not one county in this state that does not have to deal with people dumping tires, and no matter where they come from, it becomes a huge source. And we all know what kind of mosquito factories they can become and all the challenges they create for public safety. So we are in full support of this legislation to give us a tool to help mitigate the tire issues. One of the things that we like about this bill, it's good for business because it evens the playing field. It's good for the taxpayers because it saves us a ton of money from having to go out there and clean up. And I know I could give you hundreds of examples, but one of the more recent ones that really caught my eye is in Chambers County last year. They had investigators go out and catch 42 violators, but they found over 7,000 tires in Turtle Bayou. Can you imagine that? 7,000 tires that were dumped illegally into the bayous. So this is a really important issue for counties. We look forward to working with you and the committee to make sure we can get these tools to help work on this issue, and I'd be happy to try to answer any questions.
Ms. Thompson, thank you. Ms. Morales, Shaw.
Yes, thank you. Thank you for your testimony. I wanted to ask you if you could clarify what is a generator
And is a transporter something other than, is it somebody designated to move bulk amounts of these tires?
It's my understanding that a generator would make contract with a transporter to recycle those tires. Mm-hmm. And so in some of the situations that the stories that I've heard, maybe you have the generator acting in good faith, but then they may contract with a mm-hmm. transporter that may or may not follow through on what their agreement is. And so trying to track these tires, that would be a way to get to who the perpetrator is.
Okay. And the actual violator is the one who's held to this $500 fine?
Correct.
Okay. And this doesn't mean like a regular person that just has a tire and leaves it on the side of the road?
Not to my knowledge.
Okay. I don't see that in the bill. I just wanted clarification on that. I can
ask. We're not looking, and that's the thing, is we're not looking to go out.
I mean, not that I'm condoning that, because
sure,
I'm not.
Sure. No, but, you know, we want to do whatever it takes to stop it, and I think different counties will use this. I'm not sure that every county would maximize the usage of this bill. Mm-hmm. They may investigate, but they may not issue the fine.
But it sounds like this is, like, intended for bulk transporters of people that are supposed to be properly disposing of these tires?
Exactly.
Okay. Thank you for the clarification.
Chairman.
Mr. Garrett.
Thank you for bringing this bill. I'm from Hidalgo County that's down in the valley.
I know.
And I can tell you in the neighboring county, Cameron County, also has this problem. I know both county judges and the Forest Service commissioners, and you're correct, it is a constant problem. Could you briefly, if you could, describe to everybody and to this committee especially the fire danger if one of those fires catches on fire? Because I know that the counties have, excuse the expression, a hell of a time trying to deal with that.
Yes, sir.
And of course, trying to find the perpetrators of these issues is somewhat difficult, and I understand that. Do you have any experience concerning the fires?
Me personally, I don't have any experience. I've just heard anecdotally the challenges of putting out that fire, especially with the limited resources that counties have, because there's volunteer fire departments in most of the unincorporated area, and what the resources they have to put these fires out is very difficult. And so they partner with the neighbors and so forth.
Especially with what tires are made out of. You can't just go
yes,
out
sir.
There and try to put them out like you would a brush fire or something, correct?
As I understand it, but I'm no expert on that.
Okay. The coalition of other counties, have you gotten together with any of them?
Yes, sir. Through the state association, we represent all 254 counties, and we're in full support of legislation like this and others that give us those tools to deal with this issue.
The other thing is, if you get an opportunity, and forgive me, Chairman, I didn't realize that my speaker wasn't on because they have it covered up over here. As far as coordinating these efforts with other counties, again, I think you made a comment about that. Have you had any, because every county I know has this problem.
Yes, sir.
So is there a coalition of counties to try to deal with this?
It would be through our state association, yes, sir. I mean, it's talked about at every conference and in our resolutions committees. We talk about the challenges that we face, and those challenges simply tend to stay the same, which is dealing with scrap tires and other dumping, to be honest with you. It's not just limited to tires. You know, if you'll look at the letter, and there we have Commissioner Fry talking about what he would like to see in this bill is what he does for people dumping trash. He gets his gloves out, digs through the trash to find a name, and he takes that name to the sheriff. Well, if we were able to mark these bills and follow these tires, they can do the same and track and get the perpetrators who are dumping them.
Well, again, I applaud your effort, and I would encourage y'all, if you have an opportunity, because I can tell you that both Cameron and Hidalgo County are having a tremendous problem with this.
Yes, sir.
And they're spending a lot of money trying to clean up these dumps, so to speak, of especially of tires, and it's very hazardous. And so I thank you, and feel free to get a hold of my office
and I can share those phone numbers with you. I'm sure you have them.
I have them, and we work closely with them, but I hope this means that we'll have a lot more support.
Well, you have my support. Thank you.
Thank you.
Members? Ms. Mesa.
All right.
Oh, we have one more question coming.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. Could you explain a little bit more about how you're able to track the tires back to track the tires back to the perpetrator or the illegal dumper? How do you track them back? Do you know?
Well, they register the serial numbers through TCEQ, as I understand it. So they'll know that the tires were once at this facility. And then so that facility would be able to determine who they contracted with to dispose of or recycle.
That's part of what this bill does?
As my understanding, yes, ma'am.
That they would register the serial number of the tire, and then if that tire is found illegally dumped, then they could trace it back.
Let's see.
That's what this letter says.
Well, I saw in the letter from County Judge Keeter, he said the Sheriff's Department was able to track the tires back to a shop.
Well, that,
in a neighboring
that was in
county.
A specific example.
Mm-hmm.
But, and to be honest with you, I think that was one of those situations where the local tire shop wrote the name of the customer on the inside of the tire. That's how they caught
that
some
was
of
helpful.
Yeah. I mean, 254 different ways to get there, you know, through the counties.
All right. Well, thank
you. Let me get back with you to clarify that for sure, of exactly how that works.
Okay. Thank you.
Members, Ms. Thompson, thank you for being here.
Thanks.
Chair now calls Melvin Hamner. Mr. Hamner, thank you for being here. We show you registered as Melvin Hamner, Precinct 1, County Commissioner, Bastrop County, testifying for the legislation. Is that correct?
Yes, sir. And I'm also the vice chair of the Central Texas Resource Conservation Development.
Are you testifying on their behalf as well, or just as a?
I am. I'm the vice chair there. And
well, would you?
We're working with.
Okay, we need to get that into. We need to get that into the record. He'll just kind of say the same thing.
Vice chair of the Texas
Resource
Conservation Development
Council. Please, you can come up here. We just make sure we get it right.
Vice chair of the Resource Conservation and Developmental Council. And to your question.
Okay, hang on. Well, let us get that in there. We'll get you back up there.
Resource Conservation and Development Council, Central Texas Region.
Resource Conservation and Development Council.
Okay, well, let's start over. Mr. Hamner, welcome again. We have you registered as Melvin Hamner, testifying on behalf of Bastrop County as County Commissioner, Precinct 1, and also Vice Chair of Resource Conservation and Development Council. Is that correct?
That's correct.
For the legislation.
For the legislation.
Okay, very well. Thank you, sir.
I understand you have two of them, to include Representative Gerdes, which is our.
Well, we're testifying on HB 3282 right
statewide.
Now, so we'll
yes.
Keep your testimony specific to that. Thank you, sir.
Okay. So, like I said, I represent 11 counties, actually, on that particular committee, and each one of them has a tire dumping problem. In Bastrop County alone, we are spending over $100,000 a year just to dispose of these. And the council draws money from TCEQ grant programs, and we can actually do tire cleanups every other year, each county can. And then we're using TCEQ fine money to do that, and we can't keep up. You know, I spent $13,000 this year alone from the SEP, and I don't know what that stands for, grant from TCEQ, to actually have a volunteer program for people to bring in their tires. every week, our sanitation environmental department goes out and retrieves 30 to 50 tires over the side of bridges in our creeks. If they're not there, they're dead end streets. You know, and it starts out, we try to track them down, but of course, tires don't have a readily available identification mark on them. The serial numbers are recorded by the retailers when they change tires, but they don't record anything off the used tires, which is what ends up in the ditches. So, you know, in our other bill there, we'll discuss how we plan to track that. But the purpose is to find a way to get it from the retailer that took it off, the transporter is supposed to take it to the recycle committee or company, and then tie that loop in to where we can track it down and find out who's doing it. We've tried game cameras on the known sites, and normally it takes two or three tries to do it, to catch them. But there's a need. There is a bad need in this state to track the perpetrators of these dump tires, because they're polluting our streams, they're ruining our environment, our trees, and what have you.
Yes, sir. Thank you. Members, thank you for being here, sir.
All right.
Chair calls Elisa Tamayo. Ms. Tamayo, thank you for being here. We show you registered as Elisa Tamayo, testifying on behalf of El Paso County for the legislation?
Yes, that's correct.
Thank you.
Buenas tardes. Good afternoon, committee members, chairman. Elisa Tamayo, governmental affairs manager with El Paso County, and I just want to thank Representative Jones for his leadership on this issue. I believe he did a great job laying out the bill, so I'll just be brief. Say that counties like El Paso, we spend thousands of dollars every year, as everybody has said before me, picking up illegally disposed tires that are left on the right of ways, the side of the roads, and in water ditches. And they create health hazards and they threaten road safety. In El Paso, we spend close to $50,000 every year just on the scrap tire disposal, and we typically collect about 6,000 tires of 6,000 tires per year just from the right of ways. HB 3282 will allow for a better system to mitigate illegal tire disposal while also allowing counties to use the fees collected to establish a tire recycling facilities should they choose to do so. The enforcement mechanism promoted in this bill will allow TCEQ and counties to go after bad actors and promote the safe disposal of tires. So on behalf of El Paso County, we appreciate your consideration and we ask that you support this bill. Thank you.
Mr. Tamayo, thank you, members. Thank you for being here today. Is there anyone else wishing to testify on, for, or against HB 3282? Seeing none, the chair recognizes Mr. Jones to close on the bill.
Thank you so much, Mr. Chair and members. In closing, I do have a committee sub, actually to the point that you were mentioning, Representative Morales-Shaw, around generators. In this committee substitute, we will be removing generators as well as putting in a language that will allocate a portion of the fees to go towards the state to offset the fiscal note that was presented. I believe it was about $210,000 in 2024. So with that, I close. Thank you, sir.
Thank you, Mr. Jones. HB 3282 will be left pending at this time. Chair lays out HB 3604 and recognizes Mr. Vassute.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman, members of the committee, for the opportunity to lay out House Bill 3604.
Mr. Vassute, do you have a committee substitute?
I do, actually. Thank you for that, Mr.
Okay, yes, sir. The chair offers up a committee substitute to HB 3604. Go ahead, sir.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman, for the opportunity to lay out the committee substitute for House Bill 3604. In 2019, the legislature passed HB 1300, to allow for a oyster mariculture program in the state of Texas. And I think it's a couple licenses have been issued already under that program, one of which I got to tour. And when I went there, I observed their process about how they go about doing this. This is, of course, raising oysters in a controlled environment in our bays, just like a farm. And one of the issues that was raised was under the current rules that TCEQ had adopted for these licenses, they were having to go out to their pods in the bay, pick them up, and when they wanted to get the scaling enough stuff off of them, rather than just cleaning them right there with bay water, I mean, it's in the bay, and then you clean it with bay water, they had to go take it onto shore, haul it off, clean it there, put it back into the boat, and take it all the way back to the water, taking hours to do something that's super simple. All this bill does is simply says that they can clean the mariculture cages in the bay using untreated, unmodified bay water, which has literally been sloshing against this for months without end. This literally is a necessary bill. Surprising to me, but I think it's a pretty straightforward bill. Happy to answer any questions.
Mr. Vasut, will that get us oysters quicker?
I think so, absolutely.
Okay, thank you.
You know, like oysters, an American way of life. We're with you, baby.
Let's go. Members, y'all ready to move? Oh, thank you, sir.
Yeah, happy to reserve the right to close if there's any
questions. Don't go far.
All right.
Members, we have any questions for Mr. Vasut? Seeing none, is there anyone else wishing to testify on for or against 3604 as substituted? Ms. Morales-Shaw has a question.
Yes. Yeah, no, you didn't bring any. Rep. Vasut, a couple things. What is the committee sub change? Because I don't see it. I have the other.
Sure. The committee sub changed a pressure washing requirement that was accidentally put into the original as filed. Pressure washing requirement is you know, unnecessary. Are a pressure washing prohibition. If they're just using bay water, it doesn't matter at what velocity it goes onto the cage.
Okay, so you removed three.
I did.
That's correct. Okay. And so you list a couple of things here that they can't do, altering the cleaning water.
Correct.
It doesn't actually say they have to use the bay water. Is that, like, do you think that's obvious or it's an obvious inference?
I believe it's, here it is, only with water from that location.
Ah, that's what that means. Okay, got it.
So you operate a pump right there, suck that bay water in there, stick in your hose, and go to town.
Okay, got it. Okay, thank you for the clarification.
You, all right, members, any more? We got Ms. Mesa.
Yes, ma'am.
Hi, how are you? Thank you, Chairman.
Hi.
Hey, good to see you.
Representative Vasut, how are you doing?
I'm doing just fine.
So why do we think is the reason why TCEQ put this policy in there in the first place, that the license holder must remove the cages from the bay and then take them to shore to clean them? And I'm assuming that part of the reason why they asked for them to be taken from the bay and taken to shore to clean them is because they were asking them to be cleaned with soap and chemicals. And so all that might be harmful to the bay water if it wasn't taken out of the bay and carried. And so could you speak to that? Could you also speak to, will using only water sanitize the cages, or is there some reason why that there's a need for them to be cleaned with soap and chemicals?
Great questions. First, I'm not sure on the exact reason from TCEQ. My speculation, I think the way that you have phrased it, I think is a reasonable assumption. In this regard, the TCEQ has a vested interest, of course, in keeping our bays clean. And we need to be careful about what runs off into our bays. And so I could understand, you know, a vested interest in regulating that. But in my mind, the issue here was these cages have been soaked in bay water. That's where they are. They're in the bay water as it moves. And so to have other bay water be sprayed onto it doesn't seem to raise the specter of contamination coming into our base. And so to accommodate that potential issue, that's why the bill is structured in such a way that they cannot alter the water with cleaning soap and other materials in order to keep our base clean. As to your second question about why they were, you know, needed to be cleaned in that regard, I would have to defer to the permit holders. I got to admit to you guys, I've never been an oyster mariculturalist, but they need to clean the bays. In my understanding, very rough, I did stay in a Holiday Inn Express last night, is that the water has to move through there in order for the nutrients to get to the oysters and to be able to harvest them correctly.
So if the cages are in water all the time, why do they need to be cleaned with water? What is it in the cages that when you take them out, how are they soiled or unclean in some way that needs to be cleaned?
Soil and mud, particulate matter, buildup, scaling, those things have to be cleaned off in order to effectively harvest the oysters, is my understanding. Again, not an oyster mariculturalist, but that's the way I understand it.
But you're an oyster eater.
Yes, but not a mariculturalist.
Okay. The So you said the process was time-consuming.
That is what was advised to me. And the way that I observed it, for example, this permit holder that I went to, so they have their base of operations, and then the lease that they have from TPWD is quite a little ways into the bay. So they have a boat right there that they have to get into. They have to drive out to their farm, load those pods onto that boat, and then bring them all the way back. And that takes hours to be able to do that whole process. And imagine these pods, they're stacked on top of each other. And so imagine there's potentially dozens, hundreds of these. So it takes quite a bit of time in order to go through this process. Whereas they could skip a step and just come out there, pull the cage out of the water, clean it right there on site, and put it right back in.
Well, if they're already in bay water, why do we think bay water would clean it? Just because we're power washing it?
I think it's about velocity and volume. So in that bay environment, it's not exactly sloshing around in a Cat 1 hurricane type of manner. Mm-hmm. But when you put it in a hose, pressure increases, which allows them then to clean it.
To knock off the mud and dirt.
That's the way I understand it. Yes, ma'am.
Okay. And that would leave it clean enough and would not involve using soap and chemicals that would go back into the water and maybe contaminate the water.
To be honest with you, Representative, I don't know if they're even using
soap and chemicals. Can I help a little bit, Mr. Mason?
We do have a Cajun on the committee. It might be.
I'll wait.
Representative Dean, as soon as Representative Mason.
I'd love to help.
I would be glad to yield to our Cajun on the committee.
Thank you,
Representative Dean.
These are in salt water, okay? And if you've ever been around, have you been around salt water a lot? Like, no, seriously. If you notice, like boats and things like that, especially metal bottom boats, they have various things that attach to the hulls of the boat, okay? Scale, exactly. Same thing there. Mm-hmm. These things are staying out in the salt water, and the only thing they're doing to clean them is they're taking them up, shaking them around to get rid of some of those mussels and things that they don't want in a trap, okay? Putting them back in the water. Only thing his bill says is we don't have to take them all the way back to shore to do the same process. You know, cost of the gas, fuel, time, everything else to go do that, that's crazy. I don't know why they were ever doing that anyway. So anyway, it's just salt water, and salt water has all kinds of things floating in it all the time, and it's just to try to help clean that trap out. So
would you yield back to me? Or
yes, ma'am, absolutely.
Representative Mason.
For the rest of the day, I'm done.
Sorry to put our chairman in the crossfire between the two of us, but it's not just the idea of not taking it off further away, but if they did the same process close by, then you would have the risk of the soap and the chemicals that they're currently using in the cleaning process going into the bay water and maybe contaminating the bay water. That's what I thought part of the concern was.
Is that a question for me?
Representative Dean.
No, they're not using soap in things like that. They can't.
That's my understanding, is that they're not using soap.
So the same salt bay water they're using onshore, they want to use offshore. You can't put soap and chemicals into the bay to do the cleaning.
But I thought that was the reason why they were taking it away from the
bay. No, ma'am.
They were using soap and chemicals, and they didn't want it to contaminate.
You just hit a home run. Why?
Steel brush on a water cage.
That's right. Same bay water. No soap, no chemical, no nothing. Bureaucracy.
Now, committee members, I know there's a lot of discussion here among the members. We don't have anybody who's registered to testify.
Okay.
Now, if there is, if there is anyone who wishes to testify on, for, or against House Bill 3604, is there anyone? Okay. If not, the chair recognizes Representative Vassute to close, and he may also answer more questions if there are any.
Well, I close and respectfully request favorable consideration and referral to local and consent calendars. Thank you very much.
Thank you, Representative Vassute. At this time, the chair withdraws the committee substitute to House Bill 3604, and House Bill 3604 will be left pending at this time. Chair lays out House Bill 2827, and the chair recognizes Representative Burns to explain the bill.
Thank you. Thank you, Mr. Chairman and members, for allowing me to lay out House Bill 2827. So, back in the early 90s, mid-90s, and early 2000s, in the Bosque River watershed, which includes in my neck of the woods, Erath County, Bosque County, near Johnson County, Comanche County, that area up there in North Texas. We were the dairy capital of Texas at that point. But there was a TMDL program implemented at that point in 2001 in the Bosque River watershed, and it put some different requirements on how our dairies operated, on their permitting requirements, moved them from a general permit to an individual permit, and, you know, had lagoon requirements, all kinds of different things to enhance the water quality in the watershed, not just on them, but on some of the cities as well. Over the course of the last 25 to 30 years, that program has been a success. In fact, it's really a success story if you look at it, other than the fact that most of the dairies moved from our neck of the woods out to West Texas. But over the course of that period, the monitoring stations and the watershed have shown that it has worked. The dairies and the dairymen in that area are committed to fulfilling the requirements of the TMDL that was put in place in 2001. But because we've come this far and because we're where we are, it is still incredibly hard for our dairies and dairymen to get general permitting when they make an adjustment to their dairy, or if they want to change anything about their operation. They're subject to all of the requirements under individual permitting, which is different from general permitting. Costs a lot more money and a lot more time. So the purpose of this bill is to basically move them from a general permitting requirement, I mean, an individual permitting requirement, to a general permitting requirement, while keeping in place all of the requirements under the TMDL program. TMDL stands for Total Maximum Daily Load. I'm sure y'all know that, but that was put in place in 2001. I don't know if you want more information. I have, but that's where we're at, unless you have any questions.
Well, thank you, Chairman Burns. Members, is there any more information that y'all would like from the chairman? Well, if not, we'll let you come back and close, but we do have one registered witness.
Thank you.
Or, sorry, maybe a couple. Chair calls Darren Turley. Welcome back, Mr. Turley. We show you registered as Darren Turley on behalf of the Texas Association of Dairymen, and that you're testifying for the bill. Is that correct?
Yes, sir, that's correct.
All right, please proceed with your testimony. Yes, thank you.
Good afternoon. I just wanted to try to give you a little more insight on why this bill is necessary for our Texas dairy producers that are specialized just in this watershed and just in Central Texas. As I mentioned, we've had a huge fall off of dairies there over the years, and dairy businesses continue to grow in the panhandle. And part of the reason why is some of this regulatory extension that's on them versus other parts of the state. Really what we're asking to do is take them from an individual permit to a general permit, which is what the rest of the state has for all operations. We're not talking about changing the TMDL or lowering the regulation standards that are under that, which are more stringent than other parts of the state. The monitoring stations that were mentioned have shown a consistent increase in water quality, a real good success story, as Dwayne mentioned. It is just really something that I think TCEQ and all the cities in the watershed should be proud of. And with that, our producers, though, still suffer a much higher cost for permitting and much longer process to get anything done. And so, to give you a quick example, if you were to buy a piece of property next to your farm, and or if you had a piece of property that you chose to change a product that you were going to plant on that farm, that is a major amendment to your permit. You'd have to go back through with us, with all dairies, basically use a third-party specialist environmental consultant to do this. If you have that cost, you have to resubmit it, and you have to wait the timeline for the TCEQ process of evaluating these permits, which is much longer. So you can have a time period of up to a year or even over before you could access, use that land, or make that change, even though we all know it could be better for the watershed. So what we're looking to do is just make these individual permits become general for this part of the state to match every other part of the state and how they operate. Not really a regulatory change, not stopping TMDL, and we're not affecting the sampling stations down the stream. Be sure to understand that this is not really a lessening the impact of that watershed. Any questions you have, I'd love to answer them.
Well, thank you for your testimony, Mr. Turley. Members, are there any questions? All right, we appreciate it. I don't know if you've ever had to testify twice before environmental reg before during a session, but we're happy to have you both times. Thank you.
You bet.
That's right. That's it for the registered witnesses, but is there anybody else who wishes to testify on, for, or against House Bill 2827? Seeing none, Chair recognizes Chairman Burns to close on the bill.
Thank you again, Mr. Chairman. I do need to note this was part of this is a direct result of findings from an interim study that we did from our Ag Committee from last session, one of the things that we took a look at. And again, it's worth noting that if the levels were to rise for some reason at some point, all of the TMDL regulations that are in place would kick in and the current law would take effect. This literally just moves them from an individual permit to a general permit. And happy to answer any questions if y'all have any.
Members, any questions?
Well, with that, I close then.
All right. Well, thank you, Chairman Burns.
Oh.
Oh. Yeah.
Thank you very much.
All right. Well, thank you. House Bill 2827 will be left pending at this time. And the chair now lays out House Bill 2290 and recognizes Representative Cortez to explain the bill.
Honorable Chairman Brooks, Landgraf, members of the committee, such an attractive committee y'all have here. Very attractive. Impressive. Impressive, Chairman. Thank you for the honor of laying out this bill, House Bill 2290. Under the Alternative Fueling Facilities Program, the Texas Commission on Environmental Quality provides grants for fueling facilities that provide alternative fuel, including compressed natural gas, in a clean transportation zone, which includes San Antonio. Via Metropolitan Transit, who is here today, has made the decision to replace its fleet of diesel-powered transit buses with compressed natural gas buses. This decision will allow the agency to reduce operating costs as well as provide positive effects to the air quality and the economy. Mr. Chairman, I do look forward to working with you on getting this bill passed. I respectfully ask that you consider it for local consent. I'd be happy to answer any questions you may have.
Great. Members, are there any questions for Dr. Cortez?
I do reserve my right to close, Mr. Chairman.
We'll recognize that and move to registered witnesses. Thank you.
Get the store open over here if anybody needs it.
Thank you, sir. Okay.
Thank you. Welcome. Chair calls Tom Marks. Thank you for being here today, coming from San Antonio. We show you registered as Tom Marks on behalf of Via Metropolitan Transit and that you are testifying for the bill. Is that correct?
Absolutely. Thank you, Chairman.
Thank you. Please proceed with your testimony.
Members of the committee, thank you so much. We've got a fact sheet for you here about Via Metropolitan Transit. 2017, we started. We already converted our entire bus system, 420 buses, to CNG. It makes up 84% of our total fleet. The only thing that this bill would do would allow us to, in and around the requirement that we make, public sale of natural gas. We don't sell any of our natural gas currently. It's all for our own consumption, and it's an integral piece of our critical infrastructure. If something were ever to happen based on, public access to our CNG refueling plant, it would, bring our entire agency to a halt. So we're just hoping that you'd allow us this exemption to be able to convert the rest of our fleet to CNG. Bexar County and San Antonio are in non-attainment currently, so this will definitely help as we convert the last 16% of our fleet to CNG.
So the only thing preventing you from doing what you would like to do now is that in order to fully convert the VIA fleet, you would have to, under current law, provide sales or make sales available to the public with the fuel source.
Yes.
And understandably, you're not in the retail fuel sales business. And so so the bill that Representative Cortez has brought forward would allow you to finish that expansion or, conversion without having to get into the retail side.
Yeah, and it would be a capital outlay for us in order to build and man that station. And under FTA guidelines, we can't allow normal customers onto our maintenance and operation facility right now. So.
Got it. Okay. Members, are there any other questions for Mr. Marks? Okay. Thank you for your testimony.
Thank you. Thank you.
Is there anyone else who wishes to testify on, for, or against House Bill 2290? Seeing none, the chair recognizes Representative Cortez to close on the measure.
Honorable
Chairman Brooks Langroth, thank you. Attractive members of the committee that you have here. Once again.
Hey,
once again.
You got going at that right there.
That's all VIA. Yeah. Proud to be partnering with VIA Transit. This is the simplest bill you're going to hear all session. Easiest cleanup bill we got, Chairman. But local consent. If you want to vote it out right now, I won't oppose you. If you want to vote it right now, I won't oppose.
We'll take that under advisement.
Thank you, Chairman.
Yeah, thank you. Members, any questions? All right, thank you. House Bill 2290 will be left pending at this time. And the chair lays out House Bill 3352 and recognizes Representative Gerdes to explain the bill. And as a reminder, there disingenuous flattery of the committee is necessary.
I appreciate that, Mr. Chairman. Dr. Cortez gave you all the compliments, and I'll follow. I agree with him, so I'll just move right along. Thank you for allowing me to lay out the House Bill 3352. In our rural counties across the state of Texas, we're experiencing an unprecedented amount of illegal tires being dumped on the rivers, creeks, on these rural county roads and so forth. This bill does is enable county commissioners with population of 150,000 or less to establish and enforce a program where they require tire generators to uniquely mark used and scrap tires handled by the generator, therefore allowing the county to track down the bad actors. This bill is intended to track down the bad actors. I won't get off on this bill, but my Bastrop County Commissioner Mel Hamner was the one that brought this bill to me, and it seems to be a pretty systemic problem across the state. The reason I have it bracketed out to 150,000 or less, my district's rural Texas, and that's who I represent. But we'll be willing to look at some other things to, possibly bring it statewide. But this does, we're just looking for tools to enable these counties to get these bad actors that are putting this burden not only on the counties, which are already strapped for resources, but also the taxpayers of the county and Texans. So with that, I'll happy to answer any questions. I reserve my right to close.
Well, we'll certainly recognize that and appreciate you being so responsive to your constituents. Members, are there any questions for Representative Gerdes? All right, seeing none, we'll move to testimony and bring it back up to close.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman.
Chair calls Commissioner Hamner. I think we got a preview that you would be here, but just for the record, I want to confirm that we have you registered as Melvin Hamner on behalf of Bastrop County, and that you were testifying for the bill. Is that correct?
Yes, sir, Mr. Chairman, and I'll spare you the flattery. I'm retired military. We don't flatter anybody.
Good. that is perfectly fine. Thank you. Please proceed with your testimony.
Again, I'm the vice chair of the RC&D Central Texas, which is an offshoot of TCEQ to manage resource conservation and development. There are about 9 chapters throughout the state. So ours is fairly active. It includes Travis County, Milam County, Fayette County, Caldwell, of course, Bastrop, Lee, all the way from McClendon and on down from Waco. We have that problem everywhere. We have the problem throughout the state. My crew goes out weekly to pick up 30, 50 tires at a time. That's how severe the dumping is. We also run the transfer station for the county, and it's in my maintenance yard, where we give the citizens the opportunity to bring their tires in, and we collect a lot of tires that way. So the problem seems to be outside the regular citizen dumping their tires. They're one or two, but 30, 50 at a time, that's the problem. And that's what the council that I sit on, we've discussed for 3 years now. We have resolutions from 4 of the county's commissioner's court on this subject. So it's a severe problem. We did offer up a tracking method, because that's the real problem, is we can't track it back to the ones that are doing it. So we've offered up a suggestion on how to track it by putting a unique marking on it, because serial numbers that the manufacturer uses is only recorded when the tires sell, not when they're taken off. So we need a way to check that tire when it's taken off. From the time the retailer takes it off, gives it to a transporter, and it goes to recycling, because it's not making it to the recycling. It's going to the transporter and going out to our creek beds and dead-end streets.
Okay. Well, thank you for that testimony. Members, are there any questions for the commissioner? All right. Well, thank you for your testimony, and obviously you've got a good new state rep representing the county, and I'm glad that he's been responsive to you.
I might even give him my favorite title.
Well, great. Well, thank you. At this time, the chair calls Rick Thompson.
These will look pretty similar.
Just want to make sure that we have the record reflected correctly for you, but we have you registered as Rick Thompson on behalf of the County Judges and Commissioners Association of Texas, and that you are testifying for the bill. Is that correct?
Yes, sir. Thank you, Mr. Chairman, members. I'll be brief. I will tell you this is a statewide issue, as we previously discussed, but this is another tool in the tool belt. It's another way to get there to help solve this problem. We feel like this is a good solution, especially for rural counties, and it'll be an opportunity for them to help catch those perpetrators that are doing it. And once again, I'll point out two things. It's good for business because it evens the playing field, and it's good for the county taxpayer. And with that, I will try to answer any questions.
Well, members, are there any questions? All right. Well, we appreciate your testimony. Thank you. Is there anyone else who wishes to testify on, for, or against House Bill 3352? Seeing none, chair recognizes Representative Gerdes to close on the bill.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman and committee members. I ask for y'all's favorable consideration and this be sent to local and consent. And I close.
Great. Thank you. House Bill 3352 will be left pending at this time. Thank you. John, you ready? Chair lays out House Bill 4087, and the chair offers up a committee substitute to House Bill 4087, and the chair recognizes Chairman Kimple to explain the bill.
I'm going to get
yes,
up
sir,
here.
Please.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. The state currently authorizes TCEQ to regulate pump and haul services and issue permits whereby an entity is permitted to pump domestic wastewater into a holding tank where it remains until transported by truck to an off-site wastewater disposal and or treatment facility. Temporary holding tanks and equipment used in pump and haul methods are critical components of utility connections, but the lack of time limit on pump and haul operations creates the opportunity for temporary to become permanent. These operations increase the potential of spillage of untreated wastewater due to an increased number of times that this wastewater is handled, and their continued operation can risk exposure to safety hazards for neighborhoods and environmentally sensitive areas. The 4087 as substituted authorizes TCEQ to issue a permit for a pump and haul operation for certain properties for 6 months, and that was a change from our original to the substitute, was 1 year to 6 months. The committee sub, and I just said that. So anyway, 1 year to 6 months. With that, I know we have a the friend and Mayor Pro Tem of Cibolo, Texas, here to testify and ask for the right to close and stand for any questions.
You got it. Members, are there any questions? And appreciate you explaining the difference between the filed bill and the committee sub. If there aren't questions, we'll bring up the Mayor Pro Tem. Chair calls Joel Hicks. Thank you, Mr. Mayor, for being here. For the record, we show you registered as Joel Hicks on behalf of the city of Cibolo, also Guadalupe County, also the NEP Northeast Partnership, and on behalf of yourself. Is that correct?
Yes, sir.
And that you are testifying for the bill. Is that correct?
Yes, sir.
All right. Please proceed with your testimony. Thank you.
Thank you, Mr. Brooks. Commission, I appreciate it. State Representative Kimple has said, John. As John has said,
we're way past that.
I know. Yeah. I don't know if he got this letter out to you. I talked that.
He did, yes. Okay. Members,
I appreciate
that. Hard copy.
The reason why I bring this up is we had in our ETJ, and I know that there's bills out there to try and shrink the ETJ. That's fine and all, but whenever you've got developers coming in and they don't have all the utilities there. They decided, well, why don't we just do a pump and haul? And as John had said, those county roads, some of them, you know, we need funding for that as well, and I'm not here to testify on that, but some of those roads just aren't very safe to have these big, huge pump and haul trucks rolling down them. They turn over, then you've got a hazardous waste. We don't want an Ohio here in Texas. You know, just saying, I know that was chemicals, but, you know, effluent, we just don't need it. And I'm testifying on, you know, 13 cities in Guadalupe County. That's fine. Judge Kutcher couldn't make it. He was up here yesterday. I'd brought this to John, Senator Campbell, and Senator Zaffirini about a year ago, I guess it was. We got all three of them with all of the mayors of the cities in Guadalupe County to bring this up, because the developers, instead of waiting until they have utilities on site, on the property, they're going this route of pump and haul. I don't know if any of y'all are familiar with the colonies down along the border, but we don't need that up here. And I know John don't want that in his district. All we're asking for is to give us a definition of temporary. Right now, as TECQ has it, it's just temporary. So I'm glad. I know Judge Kutcher and I had talked, and I talked to John's aide, Thomas Flanders, great guy. And he put in there a year, and I just think a year is too much. I understand that if you've got a wastewater facility that goes down and there's a problem with it and they're having to redo it, that's going to take longer. But for these developers to come in and skirt the system, and that's how I look at it, is they're skirting the system. Well, we've had this one in our ETJ of Cibolo for 2.5 years. 2.5 years of pump and haul. And I don't see how these people are buying those houses in there and not realizing that they've got 3 Connex boxes. I don't know if y'all have ever seen this, but the big blue bird, rain, those Connex boxes are full of effluent. I'll just call it that. Affluent, and then they have a truck come up, hook it up, and in fact, I sent that you that picture, correct? The wastewater provider that's trying to get the lines to them, just pulling off on the side of the road and dumping it right into a manhole. Yeah. What those are doing in that, they're sucking it up out of a manhole and into a Connex box for a truck to come and get. So all I'm asking for is, what is temporary? Give us a definition of temporary. That way, you know, TCEQ can say, okay, you can do it, but you've got 6 months, not 2.5 years. So that's all I'm here to testify for. I appreciate it. I would appreciate y'all's favorable consideration on this. To just give us a definition. That's all we're asking for. Thank you, John. Thank you, Commission. Appreciate it. Thank you.
Yes, sir.
Joel, thank you for being here, Bob.
Representative Mesa.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. So besides just the, what word should I use? unseemliness of it all, what are those kind of safety hazards? You talked about an Ohio and Texas. What kind of safety hazards do you feel like that this
presents? Well, the hazard is them driving down these county roads. County roads, you know, we only get so much funds. They can only do so much. Mm-hmm. And I was out on my bike yesterday rolling through Gonzales, and I noticed some of the county roads. I know at Guadalupe, all of ours have got some type of asphalt or top coat on it. I go over to Gonzales County, and those are dirt. You know, I know I come from Wise County, and a lot of the ones up in Wise County, they're dirt out there. You know, so just slip of that and you have an overturned truck with all that effluent just going out everywhere. What I was getting at with the Ohio is you had that train crash. And
I got
that left lots of environmental hazards are still coming forth on that, and they will be for, I think, years. And all I'm asking for is give us a timeline, because instead of having to pump and haul this stuff, just make sure that the developers, okay, you've got 6 months, you better have your lines in the ground within the 6 months. If not, you can't go vertical. Because that's what they did. They started going vertical, started selling houses, and so then you had those trucks coming in, sucking it out, and then taking it and dumping it. And it's just a hazard. Health and safety is how I look at it.
And are there any fines or penalties for improper operations?
I'm sure there is. I'm sure that
TCQ,
I just don't know offhand if there is.
Know of anybody being fined or having any kind of penalties for just leaving it there.
But as John said, you know, you're going to have, instead of it going out of your toilet and in a pipe and to the treatment plant and then comes out gray water in some creek down the or tributary, they're sucking it up out of a manhole with a pump. It goes into a Connex box, sits there for a day or two. Then from there, truck comes up, they have to hook it up, and then they leave, and then they got to drive on the roads to wherever they're going to dump it. It's a lot of hands touching that effluent.
Okay, but we really don't know that there's been much in the way of enforcement of it, in the way of fines or penalties.
Correct.
Yeah. All right. Well, thank you.
Members, any other questions? Mr. Mayor, thank you for being here. And it doesn't sound like we have to tell you what a good one you got in your state rep either. So thank you. Members, any other questions? All right. Is there anyone else who wishes to testify on, for, or against 4087? Seeing none, Chair recognizes Chairman Kemple to close on the measure.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. I'll close.
All right. At this time, the Chair withdraws the committee substitute to House Bill 4087. Thank you, Chairman Kemple. House Bill 4087 will be left pending at this time. The Chair now lays out House Bill 3300, and the Chair recognizes Chairman Guetta to explain the bill.
Thank you, Chairman and members, for allowing me to lay out House Bill 3300. And I'd like to give some background context to this legislation, proposed legislation. This is a bill to protect our wildlife and livestock in Texas. It was brought to me by a local rancher, and I should say plural, ranchers, veterinarians, and wildlife enthusiasts. And something else that I have personally observed as a rancher myself. Balloons, the one you've seen released at celebrations such as graduations and parties, might look real pretty, but these balloons have to go someplace. And they're dangerous, and I'll tell you why. They travel long distances when they get up there in the air and end up falling to the ground on Texas ranches and natural habitats where they pose a serious threat to wildlife and livestock. There's no control of where they go or where they land, and can tell you from personal experience, they land all over the ghetto ranches. And I've spoken to numerous veterinarians about this issue, and it's something that they deal with on a constant basis. Ranches, we invariably find these balloons, sometimes numerous balloons, all over the pastures. Ranch animals like cows and horses are known to mistakenly mistake these deflated balloons for food and eat them. This can block the digestive tract, causing discomfort, pain, and even death in many extreme cases. And to ranchers, it's quite expensive in many, many instances. This bill makes it a Class C misdemeanor with a maximum fine of $500 for the intentional release of a balloon or multiple balloons. Hopefully, this fine would serve as a deterrent to protect wildlife and livestock in Texas from consuming and eating these balloons, which causes a very, very financial burden on many of the ranchers and, quite frankly, even some of the farmers. Members, I'm happy to answer any questions Chairman, I request the right to close.
Well, you certainly have it. Members, are there any questions for Chairman Geta? Representative Dean.
Thank you. Chairman of the board, I appreciate it. My board of chairman over there. Bobby, I understand exactly what you're trying to accomplish. One of the big things, you know, when you talk about weddings, sometimes even funerals, unfortunately, you know, first child's coming along, all the various things people release balloons about. In your bill, I think it states something to the effect of $500 fines per balloon or something like that. Is there a way to maybe amend the bill so that, I mean, in the bigger areas, suburban areas, whatnot, they don't have cattle ranches and wildlife ranches like it. I mean, when I first read your bill, I thought, man, I never thought about that. You know, the animals mistake it for maybe a food plot or something, and they eat that, and they can't, you know how a cow is anyway. They don't digest real well. So I just wondered if there's something we could do to sort of segregate, if you would, you know, either by a population size. I don't know, and maybe the chair could help as well, because out in West Texas, my God, he's got tons of wide open area too. I'm sure it's a problem there. But I'm just real concerned about all these little birthday parties and all the different things that parents do and schools do and everybody, that we're going to fine them $500 a balloon or to, I can't remember the exact detail of the bill, but I know it's a financial fine, of how we might be able to think that through and accomplish, you know, accomplish what you want to accomplish.
Well, I appreciate that, Representative, I really do, and yes, indeed, I'm open to any dialogue, okay. And willing to work with other veterinarians and other folks, especially folks in urban areas, where they don't see this problem constantly that we do. I can tell you, over thousands of acres, when we have cattle out there, and then we got to spend all that money, or folks have to spend a lot of money to haul that animal into town. And then, Lord and behold, if the veterinarian can do something about it, then you get a bill from them.
Right.
And I hate to see an animal go through that. So, yes, indeed, I'm willing to listen to any other options.
Yeah, and I don't have an answer to that right now. But I think we can accomplish what you want to do without putting the financial burden. We move the financial burden from one, you know, the owner of the property and the animals over to the people trying to have a little partay.
We gotta
try to figure that out.
Yes, sir.
Thank you.
You and I are good friends, and I will definitely work with you or any other industry. We just got to do something about this problem.
Sure. Got you. Thanks.
Representative Borella Shaw.
Thank you, Chairman. Vice Chairman, I also understand the intent of the bill, and it actually goes a little further, because these balloons go to the waterways, and it's a problem in the oceans or rivers and with the ecology there, right? The ecosystem there. Animals get harmed there, too. But I, along the same lines, of Jay here, I would say it's a Class C misdemeanor, and I think that's what you're talking about with the fines, but it's also can criminalize folks. And we know that a lot of these are celebratory things that are happening, and I would hate for a bunch of people to suddenly be charged with a crime, you know, because of not knowing. And I think that's a big problem that we have today, is we pass laws, and we, back in the olden days when we were growing up, you'd see PSAs on TV, right? They were like commercials, like when an ambulance is coming, you pull over to the right and stop. And we just don't have that anymore. We don't have the benefit of PSAs so that people can know. So I would hope that your bill passes, but that there's some arrangement to work with either nonprofits or environmental groups, which I think would be happy, more than happy to do it, because they are advocates for this, against this problem too, that they would do some PSA for the community so people would start to know, hey, don't release balloons anymore, because it has become a very regular thing. And whether it's, I don't know if you remember, but after, well, this was in Houston specific, but after Harvey, you know, the waters in some places reached the top of the trees. And something that was very notable was that after the water subsided, there was a bunch of balloons in the trees and plastic bags and all kinds of stuff that you don't think that's going to end up in some waterway, but that's where we saw the evidence. It was like the trees were decorated with these deflated balloons and bags and things like that. So I do think that sometimes a component of the bill has a PSA to make sure that the criminalization part is minimized. So I hope that we can all talk about that and figure out how the party folks aren't going to end up in the courthouse.
Representative Dean?
In the beginning, a balloon goes up. It's got to come down.
It's got to come back. Somewhere. So anyways, no, I'm willing to work with any of the stakeholders, veterinarians. There's got to be some options, but we needed to get the dialogue going because it's I don't know if you've ever seen a cow or a horse after they have consumed something like this. It's almost heartbreaking. It's very heartbreaking. And in addition, the expense involved. So I'm willing to work with anybody.
Representative Morales-Shaw, I didn't mean to cut you off earlier, but did you
I'm
have...
I'm going to settle that one, Jason.
Okay. All right. Representative Mazza.
Okay. Well, the representatives Shaw and Dean are settling it over there. I just wanted to mention that I understand about your emphasis on the rural areas because that's your experience, but my experience is similar in the urban areas because, you know, I represent Dallas in Dallas County. I can also remember a few decades ago when it was very popular, very commonly accepted practice to throw rice at weddings, right? And then we heard that that was a bad thing because the birds were eating it, and then the rice would swell up inside of them and maybe kill them or whatever. And so people started moving away from throwing rice to bubbles or something else, some other kind of tradition. So it's only been within the past couple of years that I'd heard about how balloons were bad, all this release of balloons. Sometimes it gets televised on TV in the Dallas-Fort Worth area, the release of balloons, but it's not usually for something like a birthday party. It's like for the vigils. We have a lot of vigils in the Dallas-Fort Worth area that are sad occasions that they're remembering someone whose life was lost, and they release a balloon in memory of the lost loved one in a vigil. And so those get covered in the news. And so we have a lot of those. And so then when I learned about how balloons were bad, I hadn't really thought about balloons as bad. You only think about balloons being released in the air like when a little kid loses their balloon when they don't hold on to it well or something, but that it's a problem, then I've been concerned about it too. But I'm concerned about it as an urban dweller and how often we have, as our large populations, how many balloons go up in the air, not only for celebratory, well, I guess, but celebratory or happy occasions, but also a lot of times for sad occasions. And so we do need to have something to let people know that what they're doing is not good for animals and the environment. And I think somewhat like the throwing rice at weddings, that people will find some other way, some other method to honor people or to celebrate once they know that it's a problem.
No, I agree, and I'm willing to work with you as well to solve this issue. But I will make one comment. At least they're not throwing bricks at these. Anyways, thank you very much. And yes, indeed, I'll take that into consideration.
Members, we do have one registered witness. Are there any other questions, though, from the committee members? All right. Thank you. We'll allow you to close, Mr. Chairman. And at this time, the chair calls Blake Roach. Mr. Roach, thank you for being here. We show you registered as Blake Roach on behalf of the Texas Farm Bureau and that you were testifying for the bill. Is that correct?
Yes, sir. Correct.
All right. Please proceed with your testimony. Thank you.
Thanks so much. Good afternoon, Chairman Landgraf, committee members. I'll keep my comments brief. I'm Blake Roach on behalf of Associate Legislative Director for the Texas Farm Bureau, and we are in support of HB 3300. We appreciate the opportunity to speak today in support of this legislation. Balloon releases often have harmful, unintended consequences for livestock and wildlife across Texas. This is an issue that many farmers and ranchers see firsthand across our state. Balloons that are released often end up in the fencing and pastures that cattle, livestock graze in. The littered balloons are extremely harmful and can be deadly when consumed by livestock. Balloons can also become a choking hazard for animals and wildlife. So HB 33 would help reduce litter while also keeping livestock safe in Texas. Thank you.
And just to be clear, you're referencing HB 3300, right?
Yes, sir.
Okay, thank you. Chairman Getta.
Yes, thank you. Thank you for your Farm Bureau's position on this. Now I'm somewhat familiar with that, but just let your folks know that I'm willing to listen to reason, and I think that we need to do something, just as we've discussed here, but we can't just let it stay dormant. So thank you very much, and please take the message back. I know a lot of the Farm Bureau folks, myself. Let's sit down and work something out.
Yes, sir, Chairman. Happy to do so.
Thank you.
Members, any other questions? Representative Lopez.
Thank you, Chairman. Thanks for being here today. South Texas, as you probably know, we have a lot of ranchers in South Texas, and so this is definitely a concern for our animals out there, and knowing how expensive it is to breed animals as well, you know, such as cattle. I see the importance of it, and so I was just wondering, do you have any statistics on that, like how often it happens or anything?
No, ma'am, unfortunately, I don't. Since this is an issue that isn't tracked or regulated, farmers, ranchers aren't required to, you know, send in notice or when this happens or when this occurs, but I'd be happy to get in touch with you and your office. Let's see if we can provide some data, do some research on it.
Sure. Thank you.
Yes, ma'am.
Members, any other questions? We appreciate your testimony. Thank you.
Thank you.
Is there anyone else who wishes to testify on, for, or against House Bill 3300? Seeing none, Chair recognizes Chairman Getta to close on the bill.
Thank you, Chairman and members, for listening to this bill. And again, as I mentioned, I'm willing to listen to any proposals. And with that, I close.
All right. Well, thank you. At this time, House Bill 3300 will be left pending, and I appreciate your layout, Chairman Getta.
Thank you, sir.
All right, members, we'll now move on to the last but not least bill. The chair lays out House Bill 4932, and the chair also offers up a committee substitute to House Bill 4932. And the chair recognizes Representative Lopez to explain the bill and the differences between the committee sub and the filed bill.
Thank you, Chairman, and members, for this opportunity to present this bill in committee. The committee substitute for House Bill 4932 asks the Texas Commission on Environmental Quality to revise the state implementation plan to consider air contaminants originating from outside the United States in non-attainment areas. Currently, the EPA is listing four metro areas, Dallas, Houston, San Antonio, and El Paso, as being in non-attainment under the National Ambient Air Quality Standards, NAAQS, for fine particulate matter. This designation from the EPA significantly increases the cost of doing business and results in manufacturing and refining operations having difficulty getting permits or being forced to adopt expensive emissions control measures. Section 179B of the Clean Air Act says that as part of their implementation plans, Section 179B of the Clean Air Act says or states as part of their implementation plans, this non-attainment areas would be in attainment if not for foreign sources of pollution. The EPA is then required to redesignate the area as in attainment. For example, TCEQ is currently petitioning the EPA to redesignate El Paso as in attainment. Their assessment found that 60% of the pollutants detected in El Paso are coming from right across the border in Juarez, Mexico. With the EPA seeking to tighten the NAAQS for both ozone and particulate matter within the next 18 months, more areas of Texas, including the Permian Basin, will likely be brought into non-attainment. This bill directs the TCEQ to request the EPA to provide data on foreign sources of pollution in Texas cities within 6 months. If the EPA does not provide the data in a timely manner, the TCEQ is directed to do its own studies to calculate the contribution of foreign sources of pollution. This is something TCEQ already does to some extent and is well-established part of the NAAQS process. This legislation simply puts more urgency in Texas law for TCEQ to develop, maintain, and utilize the information needed to make these determinations.
Great layout, and thank you for bringing forth the bill. Members, are there any questions? We do have some registered witnesses, so if it's okay with you, Representative Lopez, we'll move to our registered witnesses, and then we'll recognize you to close.
Yes, sir. Thank you.
Great. Chair calls Jason Isaac.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman.
Thank
members.
You. Thank you for being here. Just make sure that we have the record correctly reflected. We show you registered as Jason Isaac on behalf of the Texas Public Policy Foundation and on behalf of yourself, and that you're testifying for the bill.
Yes, correct? In support of House Bill 4932 by Representative Lopez, basically asking the TCEQ to do what they're already doing today, which is they're requesting of the EPA this designation for foreign sources of pollution when it comes to the El Paso-Las Cruces area, because they're saying that El Paso would be in attainment if not for that foreign pollution from Mexico, which about 60% of the pollution in El Paso comes from Mexico. So it would essentially, if the EPA were to provide this data, it would put El Paso in attainment. So it would be incredibly economically beneficial for economic development in El Paso. The Texas A&M University of Corpus Christi estimates that if Corpus Christi region is put into non-attainment, the economic cost would be $1.7 billion of losses annually. We're world leaders in clean air here in the United States, having reduced the six criteria pollutants that the EPA tracks 78% over the last five decades. That's something that not a lot of people know, that we are world leaders in clean air. In fact, during the COVID shutdowns, I heard someone say that because the air quality improved so much here in Austin during the first 2 months, because 50% of the vehicles were off the road, that we should go 100% electric. Well, I heard this claim by someone in the EV industry, and I thought, well, gosh, I wonder how much they did improve. And what about the people that are losing their jobs and losing their livelihoods? And being a research institution, we actually, and me having served on this committee, know that there's a lot of air quality monitors around the state. And so we actually wound up publishing research on this, and we found that during the first 2 months of the COVID shutdowns, with between 40 and 50% fewer vehicle miles traveled, that the air pollution in the city of Austin got worse. It was negligible, but it just shows that we're world leaders in clean air here in this country, and that weather has more of an impact on poor air quality than humans do at this point in time. That's not the case in other places around the world. So when we increase regulations and we put cities into or areas into non-attainment, what we wind up doing is exporting jobs and then importing pollution. And I would rather us keep the regulations reasonable and low, put El Paso into attainment, keep other areas like the Permian that are fueling the world in attainment, keep Corpus Christi in attainment. Look at areas in Houston and Dallas that could be impacted by foreign sources of pollution, and maybe they're actually in attainment, and have this incredible economic boon that we would see so that we could import jobs and then export our clean air and our economic prosperity around the world. So I think this is a good bill. I think it would be economically beneficial to the state of Texas and the people that live here and create more jobs along the way. And if there are no questions, I guess I'll stand for questions.
Well, members, are there any questions for our former colleague, Representative Lopez?
Can you explain for the people watching live that may not understand what attainment and non-attainment is? Can you explain that, please?
Sure. Yeah, the EPA, if you fall below certain thresholds, whether it's 8 hours or 12 hours, when it's ozone or PM, things that the six criteria pollutants, if you fall below these certain thresholds. Now, the EPA doesn't think there's any threshold that is too low. And I've got a comment here from some research that we published, and it says, despite toxicological evidence that humans have a natural resistance to PM2.5, the EPA has consistently applied a no threshold assumption and said that there is no level of pollution that is too low to prevent harm. And this assumption should be rigorously examined using toxicological studies and abandoned, if not upheld. But they keep trying to lower this threshold well beyond and well below anything that impacts human health. We're already there. We're at too low of a threshold, in my opinion, and based on research that we've done at the foundation, other organizations have done. We're too low. And so when you get put into non-attainment, it rigorously expands the to do highway construction. It increases the cost. To build new refining or manufacturing facilities, the permits, the delays, the timeframes that are necessary significantly increase the cost. And that's why I say we export jobs to other countries and then import that pollution. I've had the opportunity to testify in front of the U.S. Senate and the Environment Public Works Committee a couple times and talked about 80% of the mercury emissions in this country are either naturally occurring or they're from Asian sources of air pollution. Yes, it takes about 1 to 4 weeks to make it across the troposphere and impact our air quality as far here in Texas, Asian air pollution impacting us. And so we should actually discount that away from the efforts that we're doing and not be punished, but we're being punished now by being put, by certain areas being put into attainment, or non-attainment, forgive me.
Yes, Representative Bell.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. Question, does the EPA keep this data? Segregated, it talks about in the bill to request it, and you got 6 months to receive it from EPA. Do they keep this data segregated so that they could actually provide this report?
Not that I've been able to find, but there is ability to do the reporting to show with the monitors that we have in this country, there is an absolute ability to do the reporting and to do that data. And it's called for in the Clean Air Act already. That's what the 179B that the representative referenced in her layout. So we're supposed to discount the sources. And so it's possible that within EPA, they have the data. If not, they can certainly do the measurements right. And find out. And if not, I know TCEQ can.
Right, and I'm sure they can. But then at the 180 days would it be a pretty good assumption that they're not going to get that done? Therefore, it would fall on to the TCEQ?
Yes.
So that's a fair assumption.
Yes.
And so then with that, I went through the fiscal note. There's a couple of different ways that can be done, is with TERP trust funds are out of the designated account 151. Pretty expensive process to pull that off, isn't it?
I'm not advised. I hadn't seen a fiscal note on the bill.
Got it. All right, that's all the questions I've got. Thank
you. I'll get back with you on that.
You bet.
Thank you, Representative.
Representative Lopez.
Yes, another question, and just to clarify, So any areas that don't meet the standards of the Clean Air Act, those are the ones that would be on non-attainment, like
correct.
The cities that we have right now, Dallas, El Paso, et cetera.
Correct. Yeah, there's four areas in the state of Texas that are designated non-attainment that could potentially be impacted by this. The first and foremost would be El Paso.
And that could potentially cause businesses to close down if they're having to pay fines?
Yes, absolutely. I would imagine it's happened in El Paso. That the only study that I had to reference was the one from the Texas A&M University, Corpus Christi, that talks about the economic impact being anywhere from $600 million per year of losses up to $1.7 billion in economic losses that would devastate that region if they got put into non-attainment. And it'd be devastating to the state. Then you look at the Permian Basin. That's funding a lot of things around this state. And I think it's great when we have countries around the world that are importing natural gas that's coming from the Eagle Ford and coming from the Permian. It's funding our education. It's funding our roads. I love it that you've got Germany subsidizing our public education and our roads here in this state and getting affordable, reliable energy. It's not from an enemy. I think it's fantastic. We need more of that. And if you put places like the Permian in non-attainment, that's going to be significantly hampered and just make the cost of that energy go up. And expensive energy hurts the poor.
Yeah, very good questions. Members, I do want to let you all know that we do have a resource witness from TCEQ available if there are any questions. I know it's been brought up a little bit, so just bear that in mind. Jason, using the El Paso example, so, I mean, they could become a zero emissions city, right? And there would still be, they would most likely still be considered in non-attainment just because of foreign sources of pollution. Is that safe to say?
That's correct. They could go 100% electric vehicles, be a zero emission city, mm-hmm. and would still be impacted by pollution mm-hmm. from Juarez.
Right.
Still be a non-attainment.
Right. And then a lot of that has to do with, you know, not to beat up on the sister city there, but I mean, also there are some geographic, you know, geological formations in that area that also, you know, add to that. Okay. Well, no, thank you thank you both for clarifying kind of what's at stake here. I think that is important. Members, are there any other questions? Chairman Guetta.
Chairman, it's not a question so much, just as an acknowledgement. Good seeing you again. It's been a while.
See you, Chairman.
Yeah, so, congratulations. Thank you.
Thank you.
Members, are there any other questions for the witness?
Appreciate thank you, Mr. Chairman. Jason. Thank you, members. Appreciate your service.
Is there anyone else wishing to testify on, for, or against 4932? Seeing none, the chair recognizes Representative Lopez to close on the bill.
Thank you, Chairman and members. I ask for your consideration on CHXB 4932. If there are no questions, I'll reserve the right to close.
Okay. Well, thank you. At this time, the chair withdraws the committee substitute to House Bill 4932. Thank you, Representative Lopez. It's a very good bill. And House Bill 4932 will be left pending at this time. Members, that concludes today's agenda. Is there any further business to be discussed? Seeing none, the chair moves to adjourn. Is there any objection? Hearing none, the committee stands adjourned, subject to the call of the chair.